Stealing the crown jewels from the Tower of London has long been one of the ultimate criminal challenges. No one has ever done it, but one man came very close indeed. A rogue named Colonel Thomas Blood was tempted to steal the jewels and actually came to hold the crown in his hands. But strangely enough, he did not have to pay the consequences for his audacious crime. In early September 1680, a group of men dug up the body of Colonel Thomas Blood in the London graveyard. They wanted to make sure he was really dead. Colonel Blood had brazenly broken into the Tower of London and actually held the crown in his hands. How he stole the crown jewels and nearly got away with it is one of the biggest riddles in the Tower's history. When King Charles II took back the crown from Parliament and ended Cromwell's protectorate, to symbolise his power, the newly throned king had ordered that new crown jewels should be made. But this collection of jewels would soon be the target of a brave crime. Needing more than jewels to show his power, King Charles purged rebels and their sympathisers. One of the victims of the king's campaign was Colonel Thomas Blood. As a rebel supporter, Colonel Blood's money, house and land were confiscated by the king's agents. He was left a broken man, bitter, looking for revenge, and out to regain his fortune. Colonel Blood planned attacks on the king's supporters. The colonel was prone to outlandish schemes that always seemed to be jinxed, but in lucky twists of fate, he always seemed to survive. He organised an attack on Dublin Castle, hoping to take the king's representative prisoner and hold him for ransom. Days before the plot was due to be put into action, the entire affair unravelled. Dozens of conspirators were arrested, tried and executed. But despite a large reward for his capture, Colonel Blood was able to get away. Blood escaped to England under an assumed name. With several failed schemes behind him, the hapless colonel was broke and desperate. Finally, he hatched a plot as bizarre as it was elaborate. Colonel Blood proposed to steal King Charles's new crown jewels. Blood learned that the jewels were kept in the lower dungeon of the jewel house, where a retired military officer named Talbot Edwards looked after them. Edwards was the master of the jewels, and his main job was simply to guide visitors who wanted to see the collection. Edwards and his family lived in an apartment above the royal vaults. Launching his scheme, Colonel Blood disguised himself as a reverend and enlisted a female accomplice who pretended to be his wife. Together, they visited the tower under the pretext of visiting the crown jewels. Once the pair were at the tower, the gullible Talbot Edwards welcomed them and led them to the vaults and the precious gems. Inside the jewel vault, Blood's plan began to swing into action. The accomplice playing his wife faked illness, and when she pretended to faint, Edwards suggested she be taken to somewhere more comfortable to recover. Falling nicely into Blood's scheme, the kindly Edwards suggested that the lady be taken to his own apartment, where she could be tended by his wife. Several days later, Colonel Blood returned to the tower with gifts for Mrs. Edwards as a repayment for her kindness. And so began a friendship between the two couples. The phony reverend relentlessly pursued a friendship with Edwards for all it was worth. The families frequently dined together, and on one occasion, Blood brought along a young man he introduced as his nephew. In fact, the nephew was a partner in crime, brought in to case the tower. Blood told Edwards that the accomplice had a friend who wanted to see the jewels when he came to London. The colonel claimed that the friend could not wait until the tower was properly open, but needed to come at a weekend because he had to leave for urgent business elsewhere. In reality, of course, The friend was another member of the robbery team. Edwards gladly made special arrangements and arranged for them to be at the tower just before 7 a.m. the following morning. On the night of May the 8th, 1671, Colonel Blood and his accomplices made their final preparations. They each carried a sheathed short dagger. Blood took several pistols and a wooden mallet. And one of the gang carried a file. Just before dawn, they set off for the tower. One guarded the horses, while the other two put their plan into action. Nervously, they made their way across the courtyard. Hiding their weapons, Blood led them to the entrance to the jewel vault. The unsuspecting Edwards led them on. The would-be robbers were now within sight of the most lucrative robbery the world had known. As the massive iron gate swung open, Blood drew the mallet and struck Edwards across the head. The master of the jewels fell screaming and struggling. In the scuffle, one of the gang drew a dagger and stabbed Edwards, while the others rushed through the door. Colonel Blood smashed the crown, shoving the crumpled remnants into an old leather bag. Everything was going according to plan. Nothing but an easy escape stood between the gang and unimaginable riches. But Blood's curse seemed to strike again. The thieves almost bumped into Edward's son on their way out. He had unexpectedly stepped right into the middle of the robbery. With young Edwards and the tower guard in hot pursuit, the thieves scrambled away and into the maze of the winding tower. Colonel Blood and his accomplices crossed the open courtyard towards the tower drawbridge and freedom beyond. Blood's outlandish scheme was about to unravel, though. One by one, the thieves were taken down. Only Blood remained free, and as he dashed towards the escape, his path was blocked by a guard. In a last-ditch bid to escape, he drew a pistol, but as the gun went off, the guard dodged the bullet, and Blood was brought down. Another scheme bit the dust. Blood was dragged back into the tower, where he waited to face a trial for treason and the inevitable death sentence. It looked like Blood's luck had finally run out, but by the end of the day, news of the astonishing plot had spread across London, and of course, to King Charles. But this is where the story gets curiouser and curiouser. The king reacted oddly. He insisted on meeting Blood, and seemed intrigued to find out how the plot had been hatched. No one knows what words passed between the king and his would-be robber, but within days of this strange meeting, Colonel Thomas Blood was released from his cell and with a full royal pardon. Even more amazingly, Colonel Blood was granted a lordly pension of £500 a year for life. He wriggled out of trouble yet again. Though Colonel Blood might have amused King Charles, no one else understood it. A number of rumours flashed around the capital that Blood had become a spy for the king, that he tested the tower's security, or perhaps he was simply a charming con man. No one will really know for sure. And people did not even believe it when the news of Blood's death was announced on August the 24th, 1680. It was as if he was trying one last trick and had faked his own death. To settle the question, a London coroner ordered the body to be exhumed from its resting place. Was he really dead? But it appeared that the grave was one place that blood was not about to escape from.